Hello, I'm Curtis Brodner with The Purchase Beat, here to share with you my conversation with prolific hip-hop producer Kenny Segal. Kenny is a veteran of the legendary Project Blowed scene, a community of eccentric, innovative hip-hop artists from the 90s and early 2000s that grew around an open mic night. Now he's producing some of the most inventive and engaging work of his career, working with artists like Milo, Bus Driver, and a slew of producers from the production supergroup Team Supreme. Enjoy.
Crying in my underwear, I lost my sense of wonder there. No, I'm not Milan Kundera. Though this lightness is unbearable, the feeling is indelible. I'm wishing I could teleport somewhere. Transmolecularized through the secular eye. I remember when Vegeta stomped Bardock's neck into prayer. Hands to the heavens, good Lord bless him. I was a broke slob watching Ghost Dog writing post hoc. If I could muster just one good throat chop.
You grew up in Maryland, right?
Yep.
What was your like early contact with music like as a kid?
I played piano in elementary school, and then I played cello in the orchestra in middle school and high school. But from very early on, I was always like more interested in doing my own thing. Like in orchestra, I was never like super good. I was always like third chair or something. But me and my friend in orchestra would always get in trouble because we were like using our cellos to like improvise weird beat kind of things when they wanted us to be playing our parts or whatever. A lot of my initial knowledge of production and everything pretty much came from a friend of mine named Cedric, who he went to the same high school as me. And he had a cousin who was a drum and bass DJ in New York at the time. So at his house, he had a pair of turntables. He was really dope at graffiti. And he had a drum machine. This like I think it was like a Dr. Rhythm Boss machine that had drum sounds, but also had like a bass and a synth sound. So we would literally go there after school, and me and a few other people, and we used to call it Sed's School for the Urban Arts, because we would just rotate. One person would make beats on headphones, another person would practice beat matching with the turntables, another guy would be drawing graffiti, and then a fourth person would be rolling blunts, and we just kind of like rotate.
Before the World Wide Web, there was bulletin boards. So bulletin boards were like, you would dial up to this website and it'd be like a chat board. And there was a scene called the demo scene back then, where people, they kind of made their own music software to make their own music compositions. And I downloaded this program called Fast Tracker when I was maybe like 15 or 16 on my parents' first computer. And that was my first real taste of making music, I guess, like electronically. I mean, everything was super simple back then, and like nothing was super high quality or anything.
How did the technical limitations that you were facing kind of like mold your sound at that point?
Well, because everything was very DIY, it was very cool. Like, I loved the whole process of just making sounds and stuff. I had this old DJ mixer, and all my original bass sounds, because I didn't have any synths or anything like that, and there was no sample packs on the internet to download. So I used to hook the headphone output of the mixer back into the input, which would make like a feedback loop, and it just make like a continuous tone that you could then record. And by messing with the EQs and the trim, you could kind of change the pitch and like filter it kind of. And I also had this one, like, I think it was like a Boss like envelope filter guitar pedal that we would use sometimes like in the mix. So between those, we just record a bunch of weird filter sweeps, chop up those samples, and then those would be like the bass sounds that we'd use in our tracks. To be honest, to this day, I still have I still have some of those samples that we made back then, and they still once in a while pop up in one of my tracks because they just have their own tone and texture. Like, and I guess back then I didn't really think about it. It's something I think about a lot now. There's so many like now there's so many samples floating around, and it's so easy to get sounds that everyone has. Like, the tone and the texture of your sound is really determined by that source material. So I take a lot of care finding unique source material that has like a texture to it that I find like pleasing to my aesthetic. And I think even back then, I didn't really realize it, but I was already kind of developing that a little bit with the sounds that we would record and collect.
So you were originally in school for a computer science gig, right?
When I first went to college, I was on a computer engineering scholarship with a computer engineering major. I quickly linked up with some pretty well-known rave DJs in Los Angeles and became a drum and bass DJ and started flying all over the place, spinning at raves. Switched to the music school, and my parents still let me stay in college in Los Angeles. So that was definitely seminal to getting me to where I am, because I think a lot of my friends might have had parents that would have been like, all right, pull the plug, you're not doing this.
At what point in your college career did you hook up with like the Project Flow guys, like Abstract Root, AC Alone?
Before Alpha Pup and Low End Theory existed, Daddy Kev had a different record label called Celestial, which was a drum and bass label, and a club night associated with it called Concrete Jungle. And a lot of the Freestyle Fellowship guys were the MCs there, and that's how I first met them. And at the time, my best friend in college was selling weed, and we would come up there and we would sell weed to all the Fellowship guys, and they would sometimes come back to our dorm room to buy weed from my my friend. And I was just working on music, so Peace heard that beat for the song called Faking the Funk. He's like, yo, let me rap on that. And he ended up freestyling on it, and that was the first rap song I ever recorded. That freaky shit. Capitalize the flip, capitalize the lip, there it go. Posse, posse, posse up, posse got to know. When you ride, you got everybody gonna ride in your realm. This right here is the most beat up. Got them bouncing all over, cause I'm a hardcore freaker. Ooh, not a crowd like what I do. You don't want me to move on your dude, on your crew, on your who. Funny thing is, I didn't even appreciate how famous Freestyle Fellowship was. I had grown up on the East Coast, like my hip-hop reference was Gangstar and Wu-Tang Clan. That was like what I was into when I was growing up. So that Concrete Jungle was really my initial introduction to Project Load, and I just knew these guys were hella talented, but I didn't realize how like famous they were. So once Peace rapped on one of my songs and started playing it for people, like everyone wanted to know who the white kid was over at USC. Because another thing was I had a computer to record with. So everyone was like, oh shit, like I want to go to Kenny's house and like record on the computer. Because like doing overdubs and all that shit was so much easier and you could see it. Like that was when like that was still like a real novelty for recording.
Right.
And I was down to record anyone for free. And basically I was making, that was in that early phase where you're making like 4 or 5 beats a day. And you have like, to me it was just practice. Everything was practice. And a lot of them were so talented that everything we did was like, holy shit, this sounds really fucking cool. So I was just down to record and make music all day.
For those who don't know, how would you describe Project Blowed?
Project Blowed is an underground rap scene from Los Angeles from the 90s and early 2000s. It was the MCs that were too nerdy for the gangster rap scene, but way too gangster for the nerdy rap scene. It's also some of the most talented MCs around. I mean, they were, to people that don't know about Freestyle Fellowship, I often refer to them as the Pixies of hip hop, in that a lot of rock people couldn't even name a song by the Pixies, but they've heard of the Pixies. But if you ask Jay-Z or if you ask Nirvana, like who influenced them, they'd say the Pixies. Well, Freestyle Fellowship, a lot of rap fans have heard that name but have no idea who they actually are or an actual song by them. But go ask Jay-Z who inspired him, he's gonna say Freestyle Fellowship.
But I feel like even really popular, more technical rappers now, like, I don't know, like Chance the
I'm friends with Vic, and Vic told me that he used to play Freestyle Fellowship stuff for Chance. In fact, the first time I met Vic was way before he blew up. This is when Vic had just put out Internet Tape, so he was like pretty much unknown at the time. I was talking to him how I work with all the Fellowship guys, and he literally recited the first verse of Boundaries to me, like right off the dome, like right at that moment. So
what was the energy like, you know, at those open mics?
Project Blow is amazing. And it's something, to be honest, one of the things I love about my current crew, Team Supreme, is for producers, I feel like early Team Supreme had a very similar vibe of there's this competitive energy, but a respectful competitive energy, where people are like super in each other's face about like who's the best, but everyone's on such a high level that there's like a level of like respect too. And that's how people get really good at things, is when there's like, everyone's at a high level but challenging each other constantly, because like you're like sharpening your swords constantly. Like at Project Load, there was more action in the parking lot than there was on stage a lot of times, because there'd be the performance, but then in the parking lot, everyone would be battling for sometimes hours after the actual show had ended. And the early Team Supreme beat ciphers were a lot like that, in that it wasn't a competition, like there was no winner, but believe me, we all talked about who the winner was every week, like, because we were like, oh shit, like your beat was so much doper than mine. Like it constantly drove me every week to try and do something even doper.
Legendary MC piece from Freestyle Fellowship crashed on your couch in your dorm, right?
Yep.
How did that happen?
So at the time, he was living at Daddy Kev's old crib. So when they had
Celestial... He's the drum and bass guy, right?
Yeah, and he's the founder of Low End Theory and everything. So at the time, Celestial, their little crew before Alpha Pup, they had him and DJ Hive had this house in Mount Washington called the Auditorium, where they had their studio and their headquarters. And a lot of MCs would crash on their couch. And when someone would get too rowdy, they would kick him out eventually. And Peace was a kind of rowdy guy. So I didn't even know it. I was 18 years old at the time. I just knew he'd come over to, like I said, to like hook up weed for my friend once. And he calls me up one day. He got my phone number after he had recorded that one song with me. And he calls me up one day. He's like, Kenny, come pick me up. Let's work on another song. And little did I know, what had really happened is I think Kev had just kicked him out for being too rowdy at the house. And so we did a song, and it was late. He crashed on my couch. Little did I know, the next 3 to 5 years, he was going to be living in various couches of mine off and on. At the time, it was awesome. I mean, my roommates probably were always pissed at me, but I loved it because he was such a center of being a member of Freestyle Fellowship, of like the LA hip hop community. That was part of what kept everyone coming over to my crib all the time and me meeting everyone, is that Peace was there. It was just a period of intense creativity going down, because I'd literally go to class, come home, record a song, go back to class, come home, make a beat, go to another class, come home, record a song on that beat I just made. Like, it was just music flying left and right all the time back then.
Abstract Rude also bunked up with you, correct?
Yeah, so after I moved out, after my college years, when I moved away from USC, me and Ab moved in together in Silver Lake and lived together for about 5 or 6 years. And that was actually a funny story. So I lived at this house with all of my drone bass DJ crew for many years before that, and we had a fire. So I was living at my girlfriend's mom's house at the time. It wasn't like a very comfortable situation. And it was when we were recording the song, maybe it was We Marinating, the song that I did from Showtime. Anyway, I didn't have a studio set up anymore because my studio was on storage because I was living at my girlfriend's mom's house. So Daddy Kev offered that we could come to his crib at the time and record the song. And I was kind of bemoaning how I was like homeless and looking for a place. And Ab was trying to move out of the place he was at. And Daddy Kev's girlfriend at the time, now his wife, Danielle, she was like, hey, you know, there's like a house for rent right down the street. You guys should go look at it. And we literally went to go look at it, and we ended up moving into that house together. And that brought another era of like meeting lots of people, because Ab would always have different MCs coming over. And that was still when I was like down to just record everything a lot of the time. So yeah, that was a whole nother era of like lots of recording and lots of like meeting new people.
Are you still working for free at this point?
So that was the era when Ken Can Cook happened.
Right.
So I was working for favors a lot of the time. I mean, there were some things that I was getting paid for, and I was getting paid for DJing back then with like drum and bass. Ken Can Cook came out of that era. Basically, Ken Can Cook was me cashing in all my favors. I was like, hey, I recorded all this shit for you. You're going to be on my album for free.
That's a pretty fun album. Can you talk a little bit about the concept behind that?
I've always loved to cook. And the whole concept was I would invite MCs over to my house, I would cook them a meal, and then we'd do a song about it. Sometimes about food, sometimes about metaphors involving the food that I cooked. It was super fun, and it's funny that we're talking about it because I just recently decided, now that it's been 10 years since the first one came out, that I'm going to do a new one for this year. And in fact, I'm trying to... I don't know if we should put this in the article, because it may or may not happen tomorrow, but I just did a song for Paul Barman's new project that's going to come out on Mellow Music Group in a couple months. So he owes me a track for my thing. So I was going to cook him dinner at my sister's apartment in Brooklyn while I'm here in New York, and that was going to be my first song for the new Ken Can Cook project. Go for it.
Garlic, corn and salsa, filter water, soda, vodka, charred chicken, corn on the cob, and some sort of pasta. Ken Can Cook, but his lady Kim can too, and this was damn good. I didn't have to bring my canned foods. I'll just pig out like a young man should. Chill on the patio made of suntan wood. Like you'll see me here as long as there's free beers. And next time I'll bring three peers. Later.
Do you see any overlap between cooking and cooking beats?
Oh, without a doubt. I mean, same with art, like all sorts of art. I think it's all about, like, cooking is like you put different ingredients together and try and make them into something greater than the sum of its parts. And making beats is totally it's a collage of sounds, and hopefully when they're all together it makes something much greater than any one of those individual sounds is. That's why I also love painting. Like, all of these things are all, to me, like the same concept of, like, grabbing little bits of things that don't go together and creating something that is awesome.
Cool. I didn't know you were a painter.
I really just started, like, earlier this year. Basically, I have always watched Bob Ross since I was a little kid, and my girlfriend got sick of me just watching Bob Ross, and last year bought me a gift certificate for Hanukkah for some oil paints, and I started really just doing kind of his technique in the beginning. The last, like, 6 months, I've kind of branched off into more exploring my own. I'm still really into landscapes, but I've kind of been using, I use little bits of his technique mixed in with, like, more what I'm trying to do. You know, like, in the beginning, every beat kind of sounds different before you've found your sound. I still am at a phase where, like, I'll do, like, a couple paintings that look a certain way, and then I'll do a couple paintings that look very different than that, and I'm trying to find that voice.
There's a time not too long ago where producers weren't really known by name. Now you have superstar producers like Metro Boomin or Flying Lotus.
Yep.
And you kind of, I don't know, you were working through this transition. What was the process for you of, you know, turning your own name into a brand?
I feel like I've been pretty late to the game because I did watch it all happen around me. I never really, in the beginning, wanted to be in the spotlight. I'm not like a spotlight kind of dude, so I was always comfortable just being in the background. And it is very ironic to me how the same rappers that back then, I might have gotten paid but didn't even have a credit on the album when I would produce for them. Now they want to put my name in the actual track title because it makes the track doper. So I remember, like, as Flying Lotus and Sam I Am and all those dudes were first coming up in LA, they kind of made it cool to just be a producer. And I don't think I was ready when that was first happening, even though I was around it, to do that. So it took me, I feel like it was really Team Supreme. It was the early Team Supreme years. That's when I finally found myself as my producer artist brand, I guess. I hate using the word brand. I mean, I know everyone uses that word, but I feel like music is so commercialized. I hate that kind of, or I just don't like that thinking of it. But anyway, that was those. So when we had those early Team Supreme ciphers, we also would have shows once a month where we would each have 15-minute sets, because that was before everyone really even had a live show or, like, knew what they wanted to do live. And those are really seminal for me for figuring out. I would do different shit at every set. When I really figured it out was that Perfect Hair tour. Like, up until then, my live show, I still was kind of, like, doing different things every time. And the Perfect Hair tour, being in front of bus drivers' audience every night for 30 gigs in a row, made me realize there was actually a bunch of people. Like when I used to tour with Abstract Rude, which I did for all those years that we lived together, I loved that. But when I was his DJ, even when I'd have opening sets, his crowd wasn't really my crowd. They were more, like, into, like, straight ahead underground hip hop and reggae stuff, which I like all that. But I couldn't get weird and, like, do my weird shit. Or if I did, I would clear the dance floor, like, very quickly. While Bus Driver, the Perfect Hair tour, I realized the crazier, the more out there, the weirder I got, the more people, like, gave me good energy. And the more people after the set would be like, yo, what were you doing? That was so tight. And that made me realize I had just been in front of the wrong people my entire career up until then. And once I found that audience existed, it changed my whole outlook of how I perform live. Because it just encouraged me to do all the things that I love doing at my house that I thought just didn't translate to do on a stage. It made me realize that's what I should do. And another thing that I really learned on that tour was from Rory. Because Rory had this, like, and this was when Rory was still pretty early on in his performance, like, he was still figuring out his shit too, I think. But he had this ethos where he would, like, not ignore the audience, but he would just make the stage, like, his bedroom. He'd be like, fuck that this is, I'm gonna ignore that this is a show. I'm just gonna pretend like I'm at home and pretend I'm just doing my thing. and people seemed to love it. I realized how there was this like intimate vibe about that. And it just made me realize, like, when I approach performing like that, I was no longer nervous. It felt comfortable because it felt just like I do when I'm fooling around with my homies at the house. And I feel like I've really, really embraced that on the last couple runs I've done, even to the point of on the second, when we did the So the Flies Don't Come tour, Safari Owl was the opening act, Rory's homie. And he would perform on the floor. That was another thing that really
legged down. Changed.
Well, it was really because there was no room on the table for all his gear. He had all this. He had this like old broken CDJ from the 80s, and like, you know, like a tape deck and all these pedals and shit. And there was no room for it. So he would just set up on the floor, and he would just sit Indian style, surrounded by his gear. And I realized the magic of that. And like now, a lot of times I perform on the floor if I need to.
So. You worked for like a music house, right? Called Elias Arts for some time. What is a music house?
Music houses are companies that make custom music, generally for like TV commercials, movies, anything, any corporate. They make corporate music, basically. Normally you'd work there for a couple years before you get to actually like write anything. But since I had a studio at home, I would just for fun write stuff for the jobs. And I showed one to my boss and he submitted one of my songs and it won a TV commercial. And at that company, that's all they cared about is if you were selling, then they wanted you to work. So then they were like, oh shit, well now you're a composer. So then they started giving me jobs. So I used to kind of describe it to people like being on like Top Chef for music. You would basically show up to work every day and they'd give all of the composers a challenge like, all right, today we're making like rock songs, they really like the Black Keys and they really like the drums in this Coldplay song and it should be about this tempo and it needs to have a breakdown at 22 seconds when the car is revealed. Everyone go, and then you'd have anywhere from a few hours to maybe a few days depending on the job to do one, and there'd be five or six of us all competing and then you play them for the client and one person would win and get the bonus. So you were constantly competing, and it was yet another phase in my life where I had a lot of creative growth very quickly, because just like Team Supreme, just like Project Bloat, it was like this friendly competition amongst all of us. And you just get really good at things when you're surrounded by very talented people all competing against each other. And that period got me comfortable writing music that, like, up until then, if you had told me to write a classical piece or like a rock song, like I really couldn't do that. And those 7 years I was at that company like taught me that I can write any type of music and taught me just like the basics of how to do a lot of stuff that now, not that I necessarily use it every day in my own personal music, but they're all part of that arsenal of techniques that you have, you know what I mean? So I still do, as a freelancer, TV stuff. Not so much commercials these days, more for TV shows and movies and stuff like that, but I still do that behind the scenes. That's a main part of how I make my living.
Anything people would recognize?
Without a doubt. Well, right now there's a new TV show. It's super corny. It's called Drop the Mic. It's a celebrity rap battle show. It's on TBS, and I'm the head composer on it. It even says music by Kenny Segal in the credits, though it goes by super, super fast. It's the one cool thing about doing music for that show is that Method Man is the host. So I got to hang out with him a bunch. And the first day on set, it was like the rehearsal day. And they were playing one of my like super whack TV show hip hop beats, like, and he started freestyling to it. And I was like, holy shit, Method Man is freestyling.
This whole interview, you've been referencing Team Supreme. Just give me a rundown. Who are these guys? How'd you get involved?
All right, Team Supreme is a collective of producers in Los Angeles. It originally formed out of a group of friends that went to college together at Chapman University. It was like Great Dane, the Penthouse guys, Dot, Jemba. And when they first started, it was kind of like there was this one guy, Steve Nalepa, who was a professor at their college, who had a class, and he used to kind of give them challenges to like make a beat with some samples. And when they all ended his class, they kind of kept it going amongst their group of friends. At the time, I was at Elias Arts at my day job, and I think just being on Facebook, I saw them post the very first one. And I was like, whoa, this is really fun. This is kind of like what I do at my job. So I sent them an email on Facebook saying like, hey, that sounds cool. Like, could I be involved? And the funny thing is, I think it was Dane that replied to me. Like 5 minutes after I sent the email, I got a reply that was like, yeah, man, sorry, it's kind of like an invite only, like friends thing. And then like 10 minutes after that, I think they Googled me and they wrote back like, oh shit, Kenny, we'd be like super honored if you join. Like, it'd be super cool. So then I did a beat for volume two, or I think volume three actually was the first one I did a beat for. And it was just so much fun. And I didn't know those guys whatsoever at the time. And it wasn't until the first Team Supreme show that I even met anyone. We only knew each other on the internet in the beginning. So I was kind of one of the outliers of the crew because I was A, 10 years older than everyone, and B, like not friends with them all. But then once we all met up, like we all became friends, and quickly it spiraled into the, at this point, probably like a third of the crew is like lived at my house at some point. And yeah, we all just became super close. And it was a moment where we all recognized within each other this like friendly competition where, and everyone was at that moment of like a growth spurt together, and it just kind of all clicked.
What's on the horizon for you? What projects are in the works?
Well, the Jefferson Park Boys 12-inch is gonna be, hopefully we're gonna announce pre-sales, and then we were actually supposed to do it today, but we didn't have our ducks in a row yet. So that's a new project between me, Mr. Carmack, and Mike Parvizi. Some jazzy hip-hop instrumentals. That's gonna be out on Wax, and on Wax before Christmas, and then sometime early next year we're gonna put out digital on Spotify and all that stuff. Me and Milo have some new songs in the works. Ken Can Cook Part 2 is definitely gonna happen sometime in 2018. That's just in the inkling stages. And I technically have like an instrumental project that it keeps on morphing because I've kind of had it done a while ago, and then I used some of the beats on other things. And now that's always the problem with me, like making instrumental projects, is that I'm constantly using them for other things.
What's the vision for that?
I want to do something where each track is tied to a different painting. Again, it's kind of amorphous right now, but it'll be something with landscape painting and chill hip-hop instrumentals.
And I'd be remiss if I didn't ask. I found you mentioning that you were doing like a full project with Sam Herring, aka Hemlock Ernst.
You know what? I totally forgot about that. Me and Sam have like 8 or maybe 9 tracks finished. Basically what happened was we were like working on that Hot and Heavy, and then the Future Islands album came out in the beginning of this year, I think. And they've been on tour for the last like 9 months or 10 months or something like that. Like, they're like such a prolific touring band. So yeah, we're still at 8 or 9 songs. One thing that's kind of a theme of my life is I've been very fortunate to have like linked up at the right moment with certain creative people where we both like were at the right trajectory to complement each other. Starting with the drum and bass guys and caught with On Point and the Helium Crew, going through Peace and Abstract Root and the Project Load guys, to Team Supreme, to Milo, like all of these were like just random event. Like, I've never been the type of person that goes around like scheming, like, all right, who should I meet? Like, I should go to this club to like who's this person? And like, I mean, I know there are people that's how they view things. But to me, like, I just try and let things happen and be open, like keep my eyes open enough to recognize and let my intuition tell me when, like, all right, this is something that I'm gonna pursue and try and go somewhere with this.
It's like this. Come on. Back in the days when I was a teenager, had Micah 9 strained on the screensaver. Look exactly like I just smoked a Green Acre. Got that information like it was data. 1, 2, let's go. One more time. I'll do it. I got the memoirs in the rental car. Spray your homies just with a simple 10-bar. Versatile, I will crush the crew from the murk, fool. I hit them up with the 2 twisted fingers. And when they linger, the rap singer looks like Deborah Winger. Dead ringer, web slinger, dead up in the street, fool. On Crenshaw, smoking menthols with choo-choo. All you niggas get the juju. My name is like Flojo, you don't know, bro. I'm from the Blow Dojo. You're so-so, fuck them niggas, they don't know, bro. Yeah.